Good morning.
Good morning.
We welcome you to the gathering of God's people, where he meets us with his grace, he lifts us with his love, and he sends us forth in service to the world. Just a couple of quick things we want to draw to your attention. A reminder that for the grace folks, the nominating ballots are due today. You can put them in Troy's mailbox, or you can grab one of the elders or deacons and turn those into them. We'd like to get them counted today. Also, we want to give you some updates on the funeral for Lena Vandenhoek. As we extend sympathy to her family, we pray for strength and comfort. The visitation will be tonight from 5 to 7 at the Grace Church, and the prayer service will begin at 7 o'clock, and the funeral services will be held tomorrow at 2 p.m. Also, we would like to extend again a big thank you to the congregation for those who took part in the banquet experience, those of you who brought your offerings the week before. We had more than enough to meet the requirements to serve that meal. 222 adults and 8 children were served by about 24, 25 volunteers, some who came in early to prep, and some who came to serve, whether it was washing dishes and mopping floors, putting out the McRib sandwiches upon the plates with the beans and the oranges, or whether the young man who got to wear the aprons and hand out salt, pepper, and sugar for folks to have with their meals. It really was a all community experience, and we are grateful for everyone who, whether it was behind the scenes, whether it was through material support, or whether you took the time to come and to share with us. It really was a wonderful example of how we as Christians are called to love the least of these. So we're grateful to you. We are planning one in the future, so if you'd like to take part, be looking for announcements on when that would come. Other announcements, you can find them as you look through your bulletin. There's a lot of things happening, and we encourage you to plug in. But let us now turn our attention to the main business of our gathering, that of worshiping our Lord and Savior. Join with me in this call to worship. Love the Lord your God.
We love with all our hearts.
Love the Lord our God.
We love with all our soul.
Love the Lord your God.
We love with all our mind.
Love the Lord your God.
We love with all our strength.
Father, we love because you first loved us. You sent your Son into our broken world to begin the process of healing. We gather now as part of that ongoing service that we render in worship to you for the strengthening of our hearts and our spirits, that we may go to continue the work that Jesus began. We pray your Spirit might fall upon us this morning, that we would worship you wholeheartedly, that we may listen intensely, and that we would receive power to serve more diligently a world so greatly loved by you. We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Let us worship together. You shall love the Lord.
Thank you.
greets you this morning with his grace, his mercy, and his peace. Greet one another in the same way.
For our praise songs. And we asked a bunch of kids to come up because the afternoon that we did this a few weeks ago, you may have seen on Facebook a little bit, some of our junior high kids showing us how that song's really supposed to be done. So they're gonna show you some actions for it. If you feel brave enough and free enough, join them in the actions and definitely join us in singing.
Your servant Moses, righteousness be.
The word that illumines our path shines a light upon our failure, upon our sinfulness, our brokenness. And in spite of the fact that we are washed in the blood of Jesus, we still need daily to avail ourselves of that cleansing grace. Let us do so together this morning as we share in this unison prayer of confession. Gracious Lord, you have taught us to trust you, but we prefer to trust ourselves. You have offered us peace, but we continue to live in chaos. You have offered us rest, but we are weighed down with our own sin. Help us to surrender our need for control, misguided self-sufficiency, and prideful arrogance. Forgive our sin, heal our hearts, cleanse our souls, and let us find true rest in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hear these words of assurance. You are blessed by God's absolute love for you. Rejoice in that love and find healing and hope. Amen. Let's respond in song. Let us pray. Father, again, we are confronted by your love. If we look at our own lives, we wonder how you could love anyone like us, who is forever wandering, forever breaking your law and breaking your heart, a sheep who is always going astray, a prodigal who demands and then runs away, a rebel who would shake a fist in the very face of heaven. We do not understand this wonderful love that you have for us, but we believe because your word tells us so. The Bible tells us that you love us even when we did not love you, and that the love that we have for you has been poured into our lives by the one who gave his life to show your love upon Calvary's tree. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are always bringing us back when we wander and go astray. You, the Spirit of Jesus, comes and puts us upon your shoulders and brings us back to the 99. When we come to our senses, when we lift our eyes from the hog troughs of this world, we know that we can come and you will run to us and take us in your arms, and you will celebrate our return. When we lay down our arms, we find that there is victory in Jesus. Father, we thank you for this amazing love. We ask, Lord, that you would give us the strength to love you with all of our strength, that you would give us the thoughts to love you with all of our mind, and that you would fill us so much with that love that our hearts are knit toward yours. But Father, love does not stop with your love for us. You fill us to overflowing that we might love our neighbors as ourselves. Father, that is how we show a world that is so self-centered, that is so cold and cruel, what it really is to be followers of Jesus, to be part of the family of God, to belong to a kingdom that is here and is yet to come when we love one another. Father, this past week, some of us had an opportunity to show that love as we spent time at the banquet. And Father, I dare say there was none who took part who did not see in the faces reflected over those tables, over that simple meal, that there was a gratitude directed toward you. Father, we thank you that we could be your instruments of love. Yet as I reminded those who had gathered, Lord, and I remind us all today, there are those in our midst who need to see that same kind of love. You have placed around us brothers and sisters who need our help, who need our compassion, who need our hand to lift them up, to encourage them, to meet their need where they are. Father, open our eyes to see those around us who may not have enough to eat, who may not be able to afford new clothes for their kids, who may not be able to make ends meet, who are living from check to check or day by day. Father, you have blessed so many of us in tremendous ways. Father, may we use your blessing to be a blessing to others. Father, we ask that we might serve those near to us. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to serve at the banquet, and we pray that we might find more opportunities to come together, young and old, and to serve the larger community around us, to go and to be the hands and the feet, the demonstration of your love. Father, we pray for the work of our missionaries, that as we give week by week, we might build up the kingdom. We might show the love of Christ to the least of these, wherever they may be, whether it is the orphan in Uganda, those struggling in Haiti, those longing to hear the word in the Middle East. Father, may your love go forth from this place in a proclamation of the good news. Father, when we think about your amazing love, today is a day that we are brought to the reality of the world in which we live. Father, today many of us will mark the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. Father, we sit here in relative comfort, in relative freedom, yet there are brothers and sisters who are locked down, who have been placed in prison cells, who are tortured, and who even are called to be martyred for the faith. Father, we want to extend through your Spirit our love for them. We ask that you would strengthen them, that you would protect them. but in the hour of trial that you would give them the strength to stand before kings and to tell the good news of the one who died to show us your love. Father, we lift up our brothers and sisters. We lift up the young and the old, all of those who are under the cross and who are facing great trial today. We pray for them, Lord, that you would indeed surround them. And we pray, Lord, that we might learn from them, that when our day of persecution comes, we may not shrink, but we would stand firm for Christ and his kingdom. Lord, we ask that soon and very soon, we who live in the days of Elijah might hear the trumpet call, might see you coming on the clouds, our Lord and Savior with the armies, the hosts of heaven, declaring victory and coming to sound the trumpet that the dead in Christ would rise and we would meet them in the air and we would be forever together with you. Father, we cry, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Even as it is in your name, Lord, we offer this prayer, taking your words as our own again, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We are continuing in this month of the Bible by looking at the power of the Word of God. Last week we looked at how that power comes from its divine origin. And today we are going to look at how you and I can connect to that power. But one of the keys is to be open to the Holy Spirit. And as we prepare to hear from God's Word today, let us welcome the Spirit into this place and into our hearts. The Word of God from the Gospel according to Luke. We look at the fourth chapter, the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness. And I would invite you to pay attention to how the Word of God is used in this particular encounter. Luke chapter 4, the Word of God. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. And Jesus answered, It is written, Man shall not live on bread alone. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered, It is written, Worship the Lord your God and serve him only. The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, He will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered, It is said, Do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. May God add his blessing to his holy and inspired word today. Emperor Melnik II was the emperor of Ethiopia late in the 1800s. Emperor Melnik II had a very peculiar habit. He believed that there was healing power in the Word of God, literally. When Emperor Menelik II got sick, he would have the Bible brought to him, and then he would pull out pages of Scripture, and he would consume them, eating sufficient pages of Scripture until the illness passed away. Sadly, Emperor Menelik II died in 1913 after he had consumed the entire book of 2 Kings. Now, we would listen to that and go, well, that's very, very strange. Well, that's very, very wrong. Well, let's jump ahead to a more modern example. If you turn on a particular television preacher, he will begin his service by smiling and then asking the congregation to grab their Bible. And all of them will lift the Bible in the air and they will repeat this particular saying, This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. And it goes on for a few more lines and it ends up with a chanting saying, I will never, 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 never be the same. Interesting. Yet that's usually the last time that that Bible ever gets raised in that particular church service. Now, we would say there's probably something wrong with that as well. And we can look at Menelik II, and we can look at those who kind of treat the Bible as a talisman and say, well, yeah, that's wrong. But we would never do something like that, would we? I've gotten into kind of a strange habit when we go on vacation and we stay in hotels, and the kids find it amusing, I guess. I grab the Gideon Bible, and I always page to the Gideon Bible because I read somewhere that people put money in the Gideon Bible just to see if people will actually look at the Bible. To date, I have not found any money, but I have put money in those Bibles. Now, I love the Gideons. Gideons is a wonderful organization, but the Gideon Bibles, they have something peculiar that kind of fits into what we're thinking about this morning. If you look in almost every Gideon Bible, you open it up, there is at the very front of the Gideon Bible a thing that says, if you have this problem, look up this text. And then it will list the various problems you might have, from envy to fear, anxiety to hatred, and it has a text. And you can go and you can read that text. But I know people who will come to me and say, Pastor, you know, I had my Gideon Bible, and I was having this problem, and I read that text, and I read it over and over and over and over again, and the problem didn't go away. But what's going on here? We look at Menelik II and his literal consumption of the Word of God. We look at the followers of Joel Osteen and his like, who believe that it's somehow reciting the words of Scripture, naming it and claiming it will give you the power that you need in your life, or people who will turn to a text and expect that text somehow to magically change their situation in life. Well, what's going on? It is something that I like to call a belief in the verba ex machina. Verba ex machina, which is Latin for the word does the work. It is this belief that somehow the Bible can be treated as a spell book, as a book of incantation, a book that if you just string together the proper sequence of verses will automatically and every time give you the answer or the blessing that you desire. And sadly, this is an attitude of many people in the church today. Now, in the outside world, most people don't give any credence to Scripture. They laugh at the emperor who stuffed himself so much with the Word of God that he actually died. They find it amusing that 25,000 people will show up at a former basketball arena and proclaim what God is going to give them. And they certainly don't believe that reading a particular verse of Scripture over and over again is going to change their life. So this really isn't a problem for the world out there. They deny the power of God's Word. Yet we know differently, don't we? And last week, that's where we began this month of the Bible, was looking at the divine power, the supernatural power of Scripture to transform us. We said it comes from the divine origin, that God breathed into this word and gave it power. That it has power to diagnose what is wrong with this world, what is wrong with us. It can point to the diagnosis of the sin that leads to death. But it also has the power to deliver us from this body of death through the victory that is ours in Jesus Christ, that this Word of God has the ability to direct us in the way that we ought to go and the way that we ought to live, and that the Word of God allows us, as we see in our text this morning, to disarm the devil himself. Yet, how we tap into that power is of crucial importance. And far too many people are trying to access God's Word in a way that is contrary to that Word. They are treating the Word of God, again, as this book of spells, as I said, this book of incantations, this recipe for success, this just plug and play and everything will go out the way that we want us to. And what I like to say is that when we treat the Word of God like this verba ex machina, that we just kind of plug in a text and God gives us what we want, I say really this is a violation of the 11th commandment. Thou shalt not misuse the Word of God. Because God, yes, has power in His Word. Supernatural power to transform, but you cannot just tap it or grab a hold of it in any way that you choose. There is a right way and a wrong way to access the power of this particular word. And that's what I want us to talk about today. How do we get the power? How do we access that power to change our lives, that power to transform our perspectives, that power to bless and to heal, to make a difference in our lives? Well, I want us to look at that really in kind of four points this morning. If you look at the bulletin, you'll see that the title of today's message is Connecting to the POWR of the Word, the power of the Word. I think God says that if you want to have what He is offering freely in His Word, you need to approach it in these ways. You need to do these things. But you notice I said that the outline this morning is P-O-W-R. And some of you say, well, where's the E? There's people like that. They get a little antsy. Well, where's the E? Well, I'll tell you, the E right now means it's for everybody. It's for every one of you. It's for me. It's for every pastor who will stand in the pulpit, everyone who will teach Sunday school. It is for every believer to understand how this power is made operative in your daily lives. So today we're going to talk about that, the POWR of connecting to God's Word. Well, let's start with the first way that we need to approach Scripture in order to connect to the power of God's Word is through prayer. Through prayer. What was Jesus doing during that 40 days in the wilderness, in those days before the temptation of Satan? The Gospels say that he was fasting and praying, that he knew what was coming. And in preparation for his battle with Satan, in preparation for his beginning this ministry that would transform all of history, he spent his time in prayer, preparing himself, empowering himself in his conversation with the Father, his meditation upon the Word. Time and time again, Scripture says that you can only access that which God makes available through prayer. Through coming to God and saying, God, speak from your word. God, minister through your word. I love what Psalm 119:18 says. This is the prayer of David. Open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your law. And time again in that Psalm 119, the longest chapter in the Bible, we've pointed out, what you read in the words of David are prayers. Open my eyes. Illumine my mind. Clean out my ears. Prepare my heart to receive your word. And that's where you start. And I read this passage again this week from Psalm 119:18, and I immediately thought 30 years ago. Some of you still remember Ernie Runkema. Ernie Runkema was a wonderful Christian man. He was an older man when I was here 30 years ago. And one day, Ernie said, Pastor, why don't you come over to the house to visit? And so I go to Ernie's house, and we're sitting at the table, and we're conversing. And I look over in the corner, and I see these small bookshelves, and I see a rocking chair. And Ernie says, let me show you what this is. He takes me over there, and on these shelves are devotionals, there's Bibles, there's various study aids. And he said, Pastor, he goes, this is where I come early in the morning, and I sit with God. And here's where I pray, and here's where I read the Word of God, and I study. And I was looking, and he had some pretty impressive books for a layman. And I said, you must really study a lot. He says, well, yeah, I study some, Pastor, but mostly I just pray. He goes, I pray a lot. I pray that God would open my eyes to understand what's in His Word. I've been studying, he said, the Bible for 80 years. But he says, every day there's something new that I find. And when I pray to God, every time he shows me something wonderful in his word. And Ernie understood that the power of God's word was accessed through coming humbly in prayer. He didn't come to God and say, God, give me this. God, provide this. He prayed like David, just open my eyes to see what you want me to see today. And I've taken that advice over 30 years, and You know, that's what I pray. I say, God, I don't know what you want me to see today. I don't know where you're going to lead me today in your word, but open my eyes. And when I take the time to pray before I read, like Ernie, I find many wonderful things in the word of God. The first step in tapping into this power, this life-transforming power, is to pray and to ask God, open the eyes of my heart, open my ears, open my spirit, and show me what I need to see today. That's the first thing, prayer. The second thing is obedience. Obedience. What does James say? He says, don't merely listen to the word and deceive yourselves. And there are a lot of people that do that. They're deceived because they merely listen and assume. What does James say? He says, don't merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. You see, obedience is the key. If you want God's blessing, if you want God's transforming power, if you want God's word to seize your life and change your life, you better obey what the word says. And that's hard for so many of us to do what God's word says, because sometimes what God wants us to do is uncomfortable. Sometimes what God says in the world is going to require us to let go of some things that we've been holding on to very tightly. Sometimes God's word is going to say, go and do something outside your comfort zone. And we saw that on Wednesday night, particularly with the young people. They had no idea what they were getting into. And some of them were nervous, shall we say. But the word of God says to love your neighbor, to meet the needs of your neighbor. And so they stepped out in faith and they found out what God was talking about. That it's not just loving from a distance and saying a few prayers, but actually getting your sleeves rolled up and getting yourself covered with sudsy water, or, you know, putting sugar and salt and pepper into the hands of people who may have had a little bit too much to drink. But that's where they understood what the Word of God says, because they went out and did it. You know, most of us know a lot about the Bible. Most of us, you know, can quote chapter and verse. We can tell you all sorts of things about the Word of God. But does our life display that we've actually done anything with what we know? You know, you can know the Greek and the Hebrew. You can know everything about the land of the Bible. You can know everything about the Bible. But if you don't do what the Bible says, you're deceiving yourselves and you are powerless. Because the power comes through the obedience to the Word of God. Reading it prayerfully and saying, okay, now I got to go do this. I got to love the unlovable. I got to forgive the unforgivable. I've got to step out in faith when I don't know where my next step's going to fall. It's only when you do that that you begin to experience the wonder of God's word. So it begins in humble prayer. It's followed by obedience, acting upon what God shows you. The W. The third thing you need to know about tapping into the power of the Word of God is you need to understand the whole counsel of God. The whole counsel of God. There is a character, one of these young preachers, got a big following. His father is a famous preacher as well, a guy named Andy Stanley. And Andy's been kind of leading this new wave of ministers, these new emergent pastors, they call them. And a while back, Andy preached a sermon that got him into a tremendous amount of hot water. Andy said that you need to unhitch the Old Testament from your Christian faith. You need to unhitch the Old Testament from your Christian faith. What was Andy saying? He says you need to disregard 2/3 of the Bible. Basically, he was saying the God that is shown in the Old Testament is a cruel, vindictive, judgmental God, and we don't believe in that God anymore. That God is passé. That God is to be forgotten about. It's the God of the New Testament we love, the God who loves everybody and everything we do and never judges anyone. This is what our Christian faith ought to be based on. Now, Andy caught a whole lot of flack about that, but in his defense, he said, I'm already saying what other people are believing. That most people have unhitched themselves from the whole counsel of God. Now, we don't call it unhitching ourselves from the whole counsel of God. We call it having our favorite verses, having our favorite books. A big problem in the church today is that we like to cherry pick what we read. There are certain passages of Scripture that we like more than others. Certain psalms, certain proverbs, certain stories. And we return to those stories time and time again. They did a study on preachers, or preachers themselves are not immune. But most preachers preach about 90% of their sermons out of the New Testament. And most of that preaching is out of the writings of Paul. Why? Because the writings of Paul are very, very easy to preach. Very few preach out of the Old Testament for just the reasons that Andy Stanley says. Because the God of the Old Testament is scary. The God of the Old Testament seems mean. The God of the Old Testament is bloody and warlike. We want the smiling face of Jesus. And that's what a lot of ministers preach. And so what happens is the church gets this unbalanced diet. It's like they're being fed a diet of hot dogs and cotton candy because they never get the meat of the word. And people do it. My mother, for the longest time, I used to ride my mother about the fact that whenever anything would go on in her life, she would always go back to the same passage of Scripture. She would always go back to the fact that God has a purpose and plan for her life. You know, the Word of God that says, I know the plans I have for you. The plan's not to harm you, but to help you and to prosper. And that verse was all over my mother's house. She had it, put on the refrigerator. She had it in little pictures that she had laying around. She had it carved out of wood. And that was her go-to verse. Ever something came into her life? Well, this is what it says. God has a plan to prosper me. And of course, being, the snide son that I was, I said, so you're telling me, Mom, that you are a thousand-year-old Babylonian exile. She says, what? I said, that text is written first and foremost to the exiles in Babylon. Had to do with how they handled being exiled from their country. Context, context, context. I told all of you that at some point or another. But people still like to do that. Everybody has their favorite verse. It's slapped onto the bumpers of our cars. We crochet it, we needlepoint it. But the problem is you miss all that God wants you to know. I mean, does Timothy say in Timothy 3:16, the text we looked at last week, John 3:16 is God-inspired. Or Jeremiah 29:10, 28, whatever, it's inspired. No, what does it say? All Scripture is inspired. All Scripture. Not just the parts we like, the parts we understand. We can't pick and choose. I got into a fight with a professor at seminary. Imagine that. He didn't believe in many parts of the Old Testament. And so we got into an argument. I'm saying, well, so you're telling me, Dr. Bogarth, that I can just take the whole story of Jonah and rip it out of the Bible because it's not true. He said, well, it didn't happen that way. So I started to go, no, don't rip it out of the Bible. That's wrong. So why is it wrong? You've already ripped it out of the Bible. You've ripped out the story of Adam and Eve. You've ripped out the story of the parting of the Red Sea. Why don't you just physically mutilate your Bible anyway? Suffice it to say, that got me in trouble. But there's people that do that. They may not physically tear stories and pages out of the Bible, but they live that way. There is power to be found in every single part of the Word of God. There is power to be found in the genealogies of Scripture if you read them with prayer. The Old Testament, the bloody sacrifices that Andy Stanley wanted to unhitch the church from, they are the roots of our salvation. What did we talk about just last month? We talked about the Red Heifer Bridge, and we talked about the sacrifice of the red heifer and the scapegoat. From the book of Leviticus. Honestly, I think the book of Leviticus is one of the greatest books in the Bible because it's one of the greatest eye-openers to the gospel. So if we want to have power, you need to read the Bible from beginning to end. Not slavishly. Well, you know, I started in Genesis. Now it's December. I finished Revelation. Oh, take a deep breath. No. But you have to immerse yourself in all of Scripture. Not just the Psalms that make you feel good, but the Psalms that make you feel a little bit guilty. Not the Proverbs that promise you prosperity, but also the Proverbs that say if you live in a certain way, God's going to punish you. Not just the red letters of Jesus, but the hard words of Paul. The whole counsel of God. If you want to plug into the power, this is the way you do it. You know, that's like, you know, having a power cord. But you clip out different parts of the power cord so you have these segments laying on the floor, and then you say, you know, light my lamp. You can't take anything out of the Word of God. The whole counsel of God. You need to read it. All right, we talked about the E for everyone. The last one, though, this morning. Humble prayer. Obedience. The whole counsel of God. This is the most important. The most important is the R. If you want to have power in God's Word, if you want that supernatural power, you need a relationship with the author. A relationship with the author. I've been unpacking books, and I'll probably still be unpacking books till the day I move and have to unpack somewhere else. But I have a book in a box that I got from my mother-in-law. She gave it to me maybe 10 years ago for Christmas. But what makes the book special is the fact that she waited in line for hours to get me that book. I am kind of an unabashed conservative, you probably haven't noticed, and big fan of Sean Hannity. Sean Hannity was at the bookstore in Ridgewood, right by where we lived. My mother-in-law got up early, got in line to get me a signed copy of Sean Hannity's book, Deliver Us from Evil, how appropriate. And she gave that, she was so excited to give me that book on Christmas Day. And you open up the book, and there it says, To Scott, from Sean Hannity. It's one of my most, prized possessions, one of the most wonderful gifts I got because of what she did to get it for me. But I open up and I look at this book, and what do I see? To Scott, from Sean Hannity. Sean Hannity does not know I exist. 10 seconds after he signed my name to that book, closed it, and gave it to my mother-in-law, he was on to somebody else. I do not have a relationship with Sean Hannity. Sean Hannity is never going to call me up and say, Scott, you want to be on my show? He's never going to say, come have dinner with me and the wife so we can talk about politics. I may have the book, and it may be a signed book, but I don't have a relationship with the author. That would be pretty cool, though. Love to sit down and talk to Sean Hannity. I'd love to talk to a lot of people. I'd love to sit down with a myriad of authors, past and present, because if you sit down with them and you have a conversation with them, you can ask them questions. You know, why did you write this? What was this character really about? What were you trying to say by this event happening? That would be pretty cool. But you and I really don't have relationships with New York Times best-selling authors. I do know a few authors, personally, and I guess if I was interested, I could have a conversation, but most of us are not going to really have a relationship with someone who's on the bestseller list. But the wonderful thing is that you can have a relationship with the author of this book. He wants to have a relationship with you. He wants to have conversation with you in prayer. He wants to sit down with you by the Holy Spirit, listening to your questions and answering your questions. That's what makes this book of 66 different authors of thousands of years, of dozens of locations, so powerful, is because there's one author of it all. God. And he wants to have that conversation with you. He wants you to read and understand his word, to receive what he has to offer. Why? Because ultimately this is not a history book, although it is about history. Ultimately, this is not an ethics book, even though it's about ethics. This is not a book of poetry. It is not a self-help book. It is not a book on healing and riches and all these things. Ultimately, this is a love letter from beginning to end, a love letter from God to you and me. I was dating a gal in college, and she sent me letters every single day. Because she was going to school in one place, I was going to school in another. Every single day she sent me a letter. And she put on her perfume. So everyone knew when I got a letter, because you could walk into the mailroom at Northwestern College, you go, oh yeah, Scott got another letter. But I'd get those letters and I would pore over those and I would reread those letters. Over and over again, I would just kind of soak up those particular letters. Now, imagine what if I had got them and said, oh, look, it's another letter from her, and just toss it into a box or threw it into the garbage can. What would that say about our relationship? It would probably not be a very, very good one. But the fact that she was a couple hundred miles away, that was where we kept the relationship alive. That's what solidified, that's what firmed up the relationship. When she said the things she said, okay, now I believe it because she keeps telling me these things. And if I had a question, if I had a concern, what did I do? I'd pick up the phone saying, what in the world was this passage about? Yeah, that's how we treat love letters. I know older widows who have the love letters from their husbands back in the war. Separated by distance and by time, their relationships were stronger because they had that letter. They had that relationship with the author of that letter. So they knew that when their loved one said, I love you and I miss you, they knew that it was true because of the relationship. And so it is for you and I. God wants to have that relationship with us. And how does he communicate? He communicates through this word. We've got some, I'll use the term my mother used, a wingnut in the RCA right now. He got up at the last General Synod meeting. He goes, this is a dead letter. It says the Bible is outdated. The Bible needs more. We need fresh revelation. No. The Bible says that this is it. This is all God is going to say to his people until he comes again. Because everything you need to know, everything you need to understand is in this book. So you're not praying, God, show me something new. God, give me a fresh revelation. All you need to do is pray, open my eyes that I can see what you've written to me in love. Those things. Humble prayer, open my eyes that I can see. Willing obedience. If you say it, Lord, I'm going to do it. The whole counsel of God, because there is truth from beginning to end. In places that you don't expect, God can reveal himself. All because he wants to have that relationship with you. So do you want POWR today? I really hope there's none of you chewing on your Bibles when you get sick. I hope you're discerning when someone waves the Bible in the air and says, this is how to get what you want in life, and then never refers to it again. Don't be like those who just live on one verse and expect that to explain all of their lives. What I hope for you today is that you will be a people of prayer, that you will keep praying, open the eyes of my heart. My hope is that you will be doers of the word. When God says it, you will do it without hesitation. I hope that all of the Bible, from beginning to end, even the tough parts, are precious to you. But what I hope most of all for you is that you know the author of this book. That you would know that he loves you. He wants the very best for you. And he will give you the power to live for him if you live in his word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the power of the word to diagnose, to deliver, to direct, and to disarm. But forgive us, Father, for failing to approach it as you want us to. Forgive us for treating it as a pick and choose kind of book, as a recipe for financial health and wealth. Forgive us for treating it as some kind of magical plug and play. Help us to receive it for what it is, your love letter to those who believe. Lord, we long to have power. We long to be able to live our lives above our circumstances. Holy Spirit, work through the word to bring us to where you want us to be, and day by day show us new things, wonderful things in that word. We pray this in your name, Jesus, the one who is the living word. Amen. We're going to stand and sing, I think, an appropriate song that looks at the Word of God. We're going to stand together and sing the familiar hymn, Trust and Obey. At this time, we receive the morning offering. Let us pray. Father, again, we thank you for the rich blessings that we have received. We thank you that you have now given us generous hearts, that your grace may go from this place into those places where it is most needed. Father, bless both the gift and the giver as we glorify you through Jesus Christ. Amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.
I will hide your word in my heart, that it may guard me like a shining light, when it burns so bright, I will follow you. Come and pour your grace into my heart, so that it may fill me with the precious things that your Spirit brings. I will live.